please take your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Lieutenant Governor Casey Cagle. He says he's got about 20 seconds for you. Thank you.
Oh, well, thank you, John. Wow, what a, you know, that was a wonderful, wonderful speech. John and I was talking behind the stage there, and we actually said, he said he would yield me 30 seconds, and I said, well, I'm going to go a little more than 30 seconds, but that would be good. It is great to be with all of you today, and I was enjoyed being with many of you through the breakfast this morning, along with the dinner last night. And many of you heard me say this morning that Nita and I have had many, many special things that have occurred in our lives. But one of those real special things is my oldest son and our daughter-in-law gave us our first grandchild, a little girl by the name of Everett Grace. And Nita and I are thrilled to death. Everybody tells me that, you know, you love your kids, but you fall in love with your grandkids. And there could not be a truer statement than that. I will say, though, I do have to enter her into beauty contest on a pretty regular basis. And I told my son and daughter-in-law this, and they says, what in the world are you talking about? I says, well, you know, in the worlds that I live in, there are other men that come up and they talk about their granddaughter and how beautiful they are. And so I have to pull out a picture of Everett Grace and show them how pretty she is every single time, and she wins hands down. And it's a great, great joy and a great time of our life. But I want to mostly say thank you. Thank you to each and every person that is representative here today. You're the individuals that have allowed Georgia to be in the place that it is. And you've allowed me to be the Lieutenant Governor, the first Republican Lieutenant Governor in the history of Georgia. And I will forever be indebted and grateful for your steadfast commitment to the conservative principles that each of us adhere to on a daily basis. I do want to pivot for a moment and just say that I do believe that this presidential election is one of the most important elections that we will face. We have sat by and watched really the Obama administration, which quite candidly a Clinton administration is going to be no different, to where executive orders are going to be the way in which they bypass the process. I can tell you firsthand, I have witnessed the federal government trying to tell the state, violating states' rights time and time again, and that is fundamentally wrong. Ladies and gentlemen, we do not need the federal government running our educational system right here in Georgia. And we've got to stand up every single time and fight back, and we will do it. And I will tell you, when I look at issues like the federal debt, over $19 trillion, and I look in this audience and I look at each one of you and me, and we recognize that it's going to cost us $160,000 to pay that debt individually. And sadly enough, it's my little granddaughter, your children, and your grandchildren that are going to bear that burden. What we need to do as states, and particularly as Georgia, is be a leader. Show Washington and show the country what it's like to balance a budget, what it's like to keep taxes low, what it's about to make sure that jobs are growing and that we are a strong environment to be the number one place to do business in the country, and correcting and making education the very best that it can be. That's what can happen. And when it comes to our next president, I want to say a quick little story. Some years back, I had the great privilege of going to Normandy. And I want you to listen to me because this is an important point and certainly one by which touched my life. As I walked on to that island and I looked at not only all of the white crosses that were before me, but I looked over to my right and I saw the cliff that fell off into the ocean. And I looked there and thought of all the individuals that gave their life. It was pretty amazing and pretty surreal. But as I walked over to that cliff and I looked down and I saw how large of a cliff it was, I visualized the men and the women, the individuals that were coming onto, swimming into the shore and climbing up on that cliff, even though bombs were coming down on top of them. What bravery, what courage, what loyalty, and what sense of calling and duty they exemplified. And as we laid a wreath there, the emotion that filled my heart is one that I will never forget. Ladies and gentlemen, that freedom, this flag that we look at behind me today, is worth the fight. And ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know that whether we like this president, whether we had a different choice, it doesn't matter. Because there are some things that are greater than our own personal feelings. And when it comes to the next Supreme Court justices, that's not going to be a one-year issue, a two-year issue. It's going to be decades that are going to, we are going to have to live with the choices. So it is going to be up to us to carry that badge of courage, to carry the badge of a conservative principles, to make sure that we have a president of the United States that will uphold the freedoms and the liberties that we stand in the trenches and fight for each and every day. And I believe we have that man. And now is the time to unite together to make sure we do all that we can to preserve this great country. May God bless you and may God bless America. Thank you.
We got a young man who I've known literally since we were carrying him around in a basket. And I've watched him progress over the years to now to the point that he is our Secretary of State and does a great job. He's a great friend, and I value his friendship so much. Let me introduce to you Brian Kemp. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and I also want to thank Jack for the great job that he's doing raising money for the party. As y'all know, it takes that. Thank you so much for allowing me to be here with you over the last 3 days. I know I've gotten to speak to just about all of you at one time or another, so it's been an honor to be here, be with the grassroots of the party, and get ready for November. Also want to thank Mike and his team and everyone in the state party for helping organize this event, the 85 volunteers. Thank you for all of your work. And I want to thank you all. I want to thank you all for your excitement and the participation that you gave in the SEC primary. You know, that was a, thank you, that was a great event. We had record turnout in Georgia, record number of votes in that election. And I think it goes unsaid many times how much the party's support, Chairman Padgett's support, the state committee's support of the SEC primary idea. This is something that didn't just happen this year. We were working on this in 2010 when people like Randy Evans and Linda and Ann Lewis and other party leaders were having to get the rules changed so we could actually go earlier and be proportional, which is what helped us play such a key role in this year's race when in March 1st when we did the regional primary. So thank you all for supporting that as well. And also want to let you know that I'm already starting to think about the SEC primary for 2020. We're going to keep working with the states that we have. We're going to continue to reach out to others to try to build our coalition. A lot of that will depend on what comes out of the convention in Cleveland and what the rules are for the next cycle. And I'll be following that very closely, and I know that there'll be a lot of important work in that regards, but I know we're going to have some good people working on our rules committee that will hopefully allow me to continue to make sure, no matter what happens with that format, that you as Georgians are going to be voting when the race still really matters. I also want to let you know that as your Secretary of State, I'm going to continue to work hard every day through the November election to make sure that it's easy to vote in Georgia and hard to cheat. And I wanted to speak real quickly about federal overreach, and I know several of folks have talked about that this year as well. But I tell you one thing I think Americans, and I know Georgians, are fed up with is the federal overreach from this administration and the folks that he's appointed to office, like Attorney General. From telling local schools how we need to handle bathroom policy, to telling states how they need to run their elections. We do not need any more federal mandates on things that we're perfectly capable of figuring out ourselves. I'm a firm believer in the states running their own elections. I think states should have the photo ID requirement, but if there are states that don't want to do that, that's their business. But don't punish us because we as Georgians believe that's a way that we have secure elections. I want to mention a lawsuit that we're being involved in right now, a bunch of liberal groups that are suing us over our process to keep our voter rolls secure, to be able to remove people that have actually moved from the state of Georgia or deceased, to remove them from the rolls so we can keep our rolls up to date and secure. Mind you, that we got this process pre-cleared through the Justice Department back when we were under the pre-clearance part of the Voting Rights Act before we could start doing this. Now the Justice Department is actually joining these liberal groups to sue us doing that process. That is federal overreach that we do not need, ladies and gentlemen. So please know that we will continue to fight for those things that you and I believe will keep our elections secure, but I'll also be fighting to make sure that they continue to be accessible. And in closing, I just want to say something about the presidential race, like many of the other speakers have talked about. And a lot of people over the last two or three days have talked about the balance of the Supreme Court, and nobody believes how important that is any more than I do. But also there's other things to think about, like who the next president is going to appoint as Attorney General. You know, we have had to deal with the last 6 years or so with the Obama Attorney Generals in regards to elections. And I know that other Republican Secretaries of State across the country that are trying to do things like photo ID, keep their voter rolls secure, make sure that we have secure, accessible, fair elections, have been having to deal with the wrath of this Justice Department. That's why this election and getting a Republican president and electing Donald Trump is so important, so we can have an Attorney General that's got some good common sense and will rein in some of the federal overreach that we're seeing at the state level. So I'm looking forward to supporting this individual in that regard. But there's one other story I wanted to tell you why I think this race is so important. I was reading 13 Hours in Benghazi. And when I was going through the book, I got to the part during the second attack when there was one of the patriots up on the roof defending his colleagues over there. And it was written in the book that he was thinking, you know, I'm up here defending the United States freedom. I'm defending the United States citizens that are here in Benghazi trying to protect them. And nobody even knows it. And the people that do know it aren't doing anything about it and sending them any help. Now, I don't know all the background of the story, and I don't try to be an expert on what's going on, but that literally almost made me sick to my stomach to think about that situation and no one coming to help. So who our next president is, it matters for supporting our men and women who are protecting the freedoms of this great country. So I look forward to hopefully supporting with you all Donald Trump as the next president of the United States. Thank you so much for letting me be your Secretary of State. God bless you, and I hope you have a great rest of the afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian.